Beethoven's Opus 106, his so-called Hammerklavier Sonata, today often is seen as one of the pinnacles of technically impossible pieces. Yes, it's a very complex work, and moreover, Beethoven gave some metronome marks or tempo indications that are really high. Oftentimes you will see people or musicians focus on the first movement with the famous half note 138. As being really fast, if not already impossible to play. But also the adagio will put you for some problems if you really want to reach the 8th note 92 that Beethoven gave for this very long piece. Not to forget the famous fugue, very complex in structure, and for which he gave quarter note 144. We today as musicians have accepted the idea, almost, that Beethoven might have composed this grand work to be never played in the tempi that he indicated. Yet, in the 19th century, we see not so much written pieces about the impossibility of the tempi. Yes, it was considered to be a very difficult work, but people seem to have been coping with that a lot better than we do today. For instance, a great performance still resonating today was that of June 1836, where Liszt, probably if not the first, he was certainly one of the first who gave the full version of the Hammerklavier Sonata in Paris. And amongst the audience was the famous composer Hector Berlioz, who later wrote a review in La Revue et Gazette Musicale. I'm reading the English translation that is published on an article, online article written by Martin Noortuin. Noortuin is very interesting in collecting all kinds of sources and putting them together. Sometimes he's a little bit eager, in my mind, to backwards proof his conclusion. But anyway, in that review, Berlioz says, Liszt has explained the work in such a way that if the composer himself had returned from the grave, joy and pride would have swept over him. Not a note was left out, not one added. I followed the performance with a sheet music. Not one alteration was made in the tempo that was not indicated in the text. It was the ideal performance of a work with a reputation of being unperformable. Liszt, in bringing back a work that was previously not understood, has shown that he is a pianist of the future. Honor to him. As Noortuin also rightfully concludes, whether or not actually Liszt followed the metronome mark in the score is difficult to say, but Berlioz's article seems to suggest that Liszt's performance was probably not far off. Of course, if we assume that Liszt followed the metronome marks or the tempo indications that Beethoven gave for his Hammerklavier Sonata, as Berlioz actually is stating in his review, the burning question is, how long did his Hammerklavier Sonata performance take? Great thing is, we do have the answer for that. In October 1876, Liszt wrote a letter to Caroline von Wittgenstein talking about the Hammerklavier Sonata and also the duration. But before I share that information with you, let's just calculate a little bit based upon the score, the number of bars, the number of notes, and the metronome marks by Beethoven. So you have four movements, Allegro, Scherzo, Adagio, Sostenuto, and the Largo, that's an introduction to the Allegro Risoluto, which is the famous fugue. I'm not going to read all of that. It's basically very simple. It indicates here the metronome mark. There's only one metronome mark that's by Czerny here, the Prestissimo, the Presto. That's only 35 bars, 70 quarter notes. All the other metronome marks are by Beethoven. The number of bars, number of notes, and then you can multiply and divide, and then so you get a duration that's not so hard to imagine. So here are the durations of the different parts in whole beat and in single beat. So if you're not familiar with whole beat or single beat, I will link here a video. Whole beat is basically what I think the historical practice where the metronome indicates the subdivision of the note value in the metronome mark. So I'm not going into detail here. There are other videos on the channel that will guide you into this. So Allegro, 16 minutes, 15 seconds, 8 minutes, 24. So 4 minutes, 2 minutes. The Adagio, a very large work, 24 minutes in whole beat, 12 minutes in single beat. Then you have the largo. There are a few bars here without metronome marks, but it's only 20 quarter notes, 24 16th notes on the whole. It doesn't matter too much. It's 4 minutes, 2 minutes, 12 seconds. And then the big fugue here lasts 16 minutes and a little bit in whole beat and 8 minutes in single beat. Now, of course, the interesting thing is, what is the total result? The total result in whole beat for the Hammerklavier Sonata is 65 minutes and 45 seconds. So obviously in single beat, that's half of that. The Hammerklavier Sonata has only one repeat, that's the A section here. If you would eliminate that repeat, then you would have about 61 minutes. And in the single beat version, you would have about half an hour. Now, only this information is very helpful to understanding what the original tempo indication by Beethoven might have been, because you will not find a Hammerklavier Sonata that's 30 minutes in length. It simply does not exist. I think the fastest you are over 40 minutes. Most often you will be around 48 to 50 minutes. But now is of course the question, what is the information that Liszt gave in that famous letter to Caroline von Wittgenstein? So the letter I'm quoting is written in October 1876 and is actually mentioned here in the Wiener Urtext edition, a very recent edition of the Opus 160 Hammerklavier Sonata. There's a preface in which Sonnleitner writes an article about tempo, an article that we will have to discuss later, because it contains some elements that are worth debating or discussing a little bit. But this letter is really marvelous. So Liszt writes to Caroline von Wittgenstein about the Opus 106, that it has four parts, an allegro, scherzo, adagio, and prelude et fugue. So a prelude and a fugue, as he calls a largo and a fugue. Over 70 pages of impressions, if not more, and that will take you about 1 hour. So there you have it. Liszt's Hammerklavier Sonata lasted about 1 hour. And of course, if you then have to choose between one of those numbers, it's very easy to see where his performance was close to. It's no doubt that the 1836 performance in Paris, the one that was reviewed by Berlioz, in which Berlioz stated that Liszt was following accurately the tempo indications by Beethoven, that was 100% whole beat performance. That, I think, is important information, not only towards Liszt as a performer and a musician and composer, but also to solving finally the mystery of the Hammerklavier Sonata. Difficult piece? Yes. Don't fool yourself by saying that in whole beat the Hammerklavier Sonata is an easy piece, because it is not. But it becomes playable. And that matches also the 19th century comments on this sonata, that it was difficult to understand, it was a long sonata, it was difficult to play even, but impossible to play, actually not. Even not in the Berlioz review, where he says that finally someone figured out how to play the Hammerklavier Sonata, in fact proves the fact that it was considered to be playable after all. And that is an important statement also for Beethoven, because after all, why would Beethoven compose a piece of which he knew up front that it was unplayable? No composer would do something like that. This, the metronome marks are hard facts. There is nothing that you have to interpret about a metronome mark, and that's the great thing. And with a result like this, combined with the information of the Liszt 1836 and the later information of Liszt about his Hammerklavier Sonata performance, actually is a great indicator that yes, in the 19th century, most metronome marks were to be read as whole beat. If you liked the video, please give it a thumbs up, because it seems to be important for YouTube's new algorithm. And if you don't want to miss any of our updates, hit the subscribe button, but also the bell icon next to the subscription button, because YouTube is not sending you notifications for new videos unless you set your notification system with the bell icon. And finally, If you'd like to support the things we are doing here and become a member of our so-called Inside Circle, where I share also other things than here on YouTube, that would be awesome. Becoming a member of our Patreon community is possible just by clicking on the link here or below this video in the description box. Thank you so much. Thanks for watching and see you soon again.